process of emotional writing by itself, but I'll tell you the process. You may wish to do the process by yourself later at home or with someone else that you trust, so long as it's not an extreme trauma. If it's a very extreme issue that completely overwhelms you or throws you off balance, I suggest that if you're doing it, please do it when a therapist is present around, because sometimes you may not know how to handle it later, once the writing process is over. And of course, if it's physical ailments and you're already under medication, it's fine to try it by yourself. Usually we don't really record any cases of misuse of the process, so it should be fine if it's a physical ailment that you're talking about. Especially with, there's a lot of recorded evidence of emotional writing benefiting patients of cancer, of patients who are HIV positive, patients with lung diseases. So it is a fairly useful process for people who are in physical, having physical ailments as well. So as we said, emotional writing, or in other words, expressive writing, is a tool that was developed by James Penmaker, primarily because he realized in his psychological studies and in his counseling that a lot of times ailments, physical ailments that are caused, are purely because of psychosomatic reason and not because there's an external injury or not because the climatic or external conditions are the cause. So he realized that a lot of times it's the patients who do not want to release certain emotions, probably because they are too attached to the emotions or too habituated to the emotions. That's one reason. Or sometimes they have buried the emotions so deep that now it's very difficult to get it out. And because these emotions are buried deep, we have physical ailments such as blood pressure, sometimes lung diseases, liver diseases, indigestion, and a lot of abdominal complaints. A lot of these ailments seem to be caused because there is a very consistent emotional pressure which is not being expressed. So that was the premise on the basis of which this technique was started. Of course, there have been improvements in terms of the structure of the technique. How it works is to emotion. What we're talking about is emotional writing, which means we're talking of leaving the emotion and not just the incident. So let's say, for example, if we take the case of, a widely prevalent case for which this is used is sexual abuse in children, right? And which is carried forward a lot of times as adults. So a lot of times when we see written material that's available, the incident, if it's a very deeply buried condition, a lot of times the writing factor is something like the incident happened at this place, at this time, and this person was involved, and you know, it's largely a description of the setting, that I was at home and an uncle came in, or right? It's purely an environment description which comes in the first session. What I'd suggest is if you see that kind of a description coming in the second, third, and the fourth sessions, please make an attempt to talk more about how you feel about it. So, alright, we were alone at home, an uncle came in, things happened, what did I feel at that point in time? So I felt angry, betrayed, confused sometimes. As kids, you don't know what's happening sometimes, so maybe confused, maybe scared. What were the feelings at that point in time, not just what is the incident at that point. And then graduate towards talking about what is your feeling now about that incident. Right? We spoke about what is the feeling then, and then what is your feeling now. In sometimes, with some patients, it also evolves in terms of a graduation of feelings. So at that point in time, as a kid, I felt confused. Then later, as a teenager, when I realized what happened to me, I was extremely angry. Then maybe when I was in my 20s, I felt upset, I felt victimized. So you see a gradation of the emotion, how the emotion has evolved with situations. And then you can come to the current state of life and say, now, in whatever state of life, in whatever age I am in, I feel whatever. You may still feel victimized, you may still feel upset, you may wonder why it happened to you. That's again a very common response that happens. So look at the emotional evolution, don't stay stuck with the experience. Because the purpose of emotional writing is to get over the experience. Purely look at the emotional content of the event and then move on from the emotion as well. So if you're writing by yourself, please pay attention to how the content evolves. If it's too much of a reliving of merely the incident, then it wouldn't really help. So we need to get to the emotional part of the incident and not just the environmental context of the incident. So please do pay attention to that. So sometimes it helps to have a cue card containing questions in front of you if you're doing the exercise alone. And normally the questions that are contained on the cue card are, firstly of course, what is the incident or the event, or sometimes just the person that you have identified. Next is, how did you feel then? Then is whichever point of time in life the event or the incident or the person was present. Next is, how do you feel now at this point in time? That's another important important for us to know if we intend to use it as a tool. It tends to cause distress, it tends to cause depression because you're bringing out emotions that perhaps lie buried, the emotions that sometimes lie completely unacknowledged as well. So don't be surprised if you're feeling depressed when you start emotional writing. It's all right, go through the process nevertheless. Don't stop the process, that's very important. Once you've started it, please complete the process. So if you've spoken of about four sessions a week, ensure that you do your four sessions a week. If it gets overwhelming after four sessions, you may stop for a few days and then start again if you think you've not released it completely. How do we realize we've not released it completely is when we still identify with the emotion, a recall, a memory of the incident, if it still causes an upsurge of emotion, and that emotion could be anger, it could be sadness, it could be grief. If you still feel that, then it means you still not overcome it. So do restart the process, but give it a break. Don't do it completely. Don't overwhelm yourself with it. Which is why, again, we say not more than 20 minutes at a time. In a therapeutic setting, you would normally do 20 minutes of writing, and usually the patient is given about 10 minutes after to compose himself or herself, because very often there is a breakdown in the early stages, which is normal and which is healthy. So again, don't be scared of the fact that it's causing those upheavals. It's meant to cause upheavals. The way the process works is that because you write out emotions, one thing that happens is you identify the emotions very clearly on paper. Right? And so it's not really about talking to yourself about it, because very often when we feel sad, we verbally acknowledge that, okay, I'm feeling sad. The next natural response is, all right, let me do something that will make me happy. So you don't stay with the emotion. So you go listen to music, you go out for a walk, you go and dance, but you don't stay with the emotion. Here, because you're writing it out, you stay with the emotion. And simply in that acknowledgement, there is a sense of healing, because you acknowledge the fact that, yes, I went through this. That's one factor that causes the healing. Secondly, emotional writing happens in a series of sessions. So it's not just one time that you write about it. You repeatedly write about the same incident for those four or five sessions that you do. So you realize that in the course of the sessions, you get familiar with the emotion, and then it's not so scary anymore. The sheer familiarity with it brings down the power of the emotion, because you realize, all right, I know this, so what? In spite of it, I've moved on, I still live, which means it's all right. It was not a very big deal. So the familiarity brings about a sense of healing. So that's another thing that happens in the process. Also, with a lot of, in a lot of cases where the patient is easily able to accept without too much of help, and therefore there was a lot of frustration in the mother, which got projected onto the child. So as she started writing, as she started dialoguing through the writing, a lot of responses came to her, and the mother's perspective came to her, which eventually closed the relationship. Instead of the anger being there, it closed in terms of saying, alright, this was what my mother's purpose was in my life. I understand that now, and now I let her go. And there was a proper closure. So that's a classic case study that's used here. So yes, in the initial few sessions, do expect distress, do expect depression. It's normal. And when you're scheduling your writing sessions, if you're doing it by yourself, do ensure that you have at least 30-40 minutes when no one will disturb you, no phone calls or doorbells or people walking in and out, because a lot of times you end up crying out, screaming out, which is normal and which is healthy. So ensure that there is adequate privacy that you have for yourself. And if you wish, you can always destroy the paper that you've written on. If you wish to, you can keep it. That's entirely up to you. A lot of times it helps if you share what you have written with somebody that you trust. It could be partner, spouse, friend, whoever. If you do wish to share, it's a healthy process, because then the person can also give you another perspective to it. And it doesn't have to be a therapist if it's not an extreme case. Unless you're in an extreme emotional distress, it's fine if you share it with anybody else also. But very importantly, remember to complete the process. Please don't leave it midway. Because then you've stirred up the emotion and not dealt with it, that's more likely to affect you physically. So if you started the process, ensure that you continue it to a point where the emotion does not cause distress. You may recognize the emotion. You may still say, okay, I remember this particular incident that happened when I was 18. But it's just a memory and it doesn't overwhelm you now. That's the kind of response you need to reach with the therapy. So till the time you've not got there, do repeat the process. But at the same time, standard rules, not more than 15-20 minutes one time, about 4 sessions a week. Usually we do 4 continuous days, because then it keeps flowing. Any language is fine, but the ground rule is you have to write for 20 minutes, no matter what. Even if you think you're repeating the same thing, we still continue writing. We don't stop writing till 20 minutes are up. And if you think you're not entirely neutralized by the end of the week, you can repeat the process later. But give it a couple of days break and then restart the process. Don't do it continuously. Yes, sir?
In the first place, I mean, for you to understand as to why you should communicate with the person who is there and wrong. We have been advised that you pray, you pray for them for the further progress. And if it was clear, why was she not able to understand the good points of her mother? I'm sure enough, you see, that she must have, along with the bad, there must be also a little bit of good. And she was unfair to herself when she only magnified the negative part of it and forgot all about the positive part of it. The positive part of it came much later when she was in communication.
Right. See, here we're not talking of communication as in a seance. We're not really talking of calling the spirit.
No, but
it's about her communication with herself. See, a lot of times, a lot of relationships, like let's say motherhood or fathers or brothers or sisters, we're talking of communicating with the archetype of the mother within self.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's not about communicating with the dead mother as in the spirit of the mother. What Claire was going through was the fact that she magnified the negativity of the mother, which very often happens to us. The reason why that happens is because a lot of times we like to have that villain in our life. We like to have that villain in our life because it's very comfortable. Anything that goes wrong in your life, you have that person to blame.
She was not fair to herself. What I want to point
people. A lot of times we are not. It's just that that comes with a lot of emotional maturity, which not everyone may be born with. You can evolve to it, certainly. But not everyone may be at it.
What would you say about not communicating with the dead Let her answer.
Okay, here it's not recall. Yeah, it's not recall in the sense of calling back the spirit or calling back the mother. It's about dealing with her emotions which she had left in childhood. Right? What she is doing here is dealing with her own emotion. Claire, if you look at it, Claire at this point may be 50 years old, but somewhere emotional growth stopped at 11 when mother compared her to her brother. So she's emotionally stuck there, and so what she's recalling is herself as a child, not so much recalling the dead mother. Of course, I mean, as a spiritualist idea, there are processes to communicate with the dead and all of that, but there again, the idea is not that you would halt another person's progress, because even when you do communicate with a spirit, the spirit would not come unless there is consensus. So it's always about taking permission of the spirit before you fall. So if that spirit feels that he or she is being blocked, he wouldn't come. So archetype is, in very simple terms, it would be strong social conditioning of certain things. For example, you would have psychologically, the concept of archetype was started by Sigmund Freud and then elaborated by Carl Jung and several other psychologists. Archetype is mainly what we believe a certain person should be. Like, let's say if I throw a random word at you, I say mother. Okay? Normally the thing that comes to mind when you say mother is nurturing and caring and sacrificing and all of that, which is a typical social conditioned thing that's
your idea.
Yeah, your idea. And an archetype is not an individual idea, but a mass idea. What the collective consciousness believes of a certain role becomes an archetype. Or let's say if I throw you another archetype of a nurse. Okay, nurse, again, you talk of white uniform, caring, service. That's typically the kind of social belief that you have when you say nurse.
Ideal mental framework.
Yes. Ideal or may not be necessarily ideal. Like, for example, if I throw terrorist, it's not ideal, but still there is an archetype of a terrorist, like scary and destructive and all of that. So there are a lot of social archetypes that we live.
You said that we like to keep fun within an archetype.
Yes. We like to, a lot of us like to keep that villain in our life, but firstly because it's very nice to, it's a very comfortable feeling to be a victim.
What do you mean victim exactly?
Victim in the sense, let's say, teacher in my school told me I'm good for nothing. And because teacher in my school told me I'm good for nothing, I can't do anything about my life. So I may as well do nothing in life and blame the teacher. Teacher said I'm good for nothing, what can I do?
You have a sense of discrimination. You can also judge the teacher.
Yes, but then it's very comfortable for me to be a victim and say I don't want to do anything in life. It's, in other words, lack of responsibility. And that lack of responsibility sometimes is comforting because you don't have to do anything. So there is no sense of ownership of life. My life is ruled by the teacher in the 8th standard. Right? I mean, who may not exist now, but then I always have someone to blame. So that's why we like those villains in our life, because we can give up responsibility. In a sense, it's not, it doesn't really come from a sense of laziness, that's not the point here, but it comes from the fact that a lot of times we are scared to discover our own power, because with that power comes the choice to use that power, right? So if I were to, let's say if I were an abused child and I grew up saying somebody abused me as a kid, which means I'm helpless, I'm powerless, right? I grew up with that belief because somebody overpowered me in a certain situation and I could not do anything about it. I have a choice to say, okay, I'm helpless, I'm powerless, I couldn't do anything about it, I have to be afraid of people who are, maybe I have to be afraid of all men in my life, maybe I have to be afraid of all men who are older. Right? I could grow up with all that belief. Now, the comfort that belief can give me is the fact that there are situations in life where I'm bound to be helpless, bound to be powerless, and I can't do anything about it. And therefore, with success comes the responsibility to revel in it. With success comes the responsibility to be happy. And sometimes we're scared of being happy. And why are we scared of being happy is because suddenly if I change from having all those problems in life and having all that knee pain and mother-in-law and all of that, and suddenly I become happy, then what will people think of me? I don't get all the attention I get now because I'm a victim. Now that mother-in-law is gone and my knee pain is gone, who's going to ask after me? Then I say I may as well get the negative attention that I'm getting. So it's, in a sense, it's about the fact that do I trust my relationships at all? Do I think people give me attention purely because of the pain? Or am I worthy of positive attention?
So we are afraid of breaking our comfort zone.
Yeah. And more often than not, the comfort zone arrests us. Because it doesn't really lead to growth. Most people in the same, you see, entire country is reveling in misery. So India loves to have Pakistan because what else will you talk about otherwise?
If
India doesn't have Pakistan, we'll have to grow.
Yeah.
Who's going to take the onus of growth? So it's we love to revel in that misery, which is something that is very prevalent in the collective consciousness, and therefore it's very much there in individuals. Now, as more and more individuals come out of it, the collective will change. Which we see, I mean, if you talk of it purely from a consciousness perspective, you look at the change that's happened in Egypt or in Libya, you see the collective consciousness shifted. People said we don't want to be a victim and the whole country turned around. So it's that individual consciousness affecting the mass consciousness. Any questions about the process?
One issue could lead to many issues around it while writing.
Oh yes,
so
that's possible.
Okay. It's like coming out of self-pity. Yes. Come out of a self-pity situation, which could be very helpful.
Oh yes, it's very helpful. Yes, you're talking of one issue leading to another issue, or you come to the realization that yes, something else is also bothering me. Yes.
So it could be like 20 minutes may not be enough because you're not writing
about
one.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're just flowing with the flow, then maybe 10 other things may crop up at the same time. Then
I would still suggest don't go beyond 20 minutes. It gets overwhelming. You get stuck with it, and in the process, the rest of your life, the rest of your day is affected, right? You've got things to handle at home and all of that, or at work.
Theoretically,
so
if you go a little more ahead, it's not harmful.
It can get extremely overwhelming in the sense. A lot of times it very clearly, first two sessions very clearly lead to depression, which is okay because it's mild depression. It can be handled without medicines and therapists and all that. Yes, but if you overdo it, it can lead to an intense situation which you don't want to. Right? Because the process is there, it's not going anywhere, so why be in a hurry? Right? If you've lived with something for 10 years, 10 more days will not matter. Yeah, but at least give yourself that ease, because remember that the process doesn't end in that 20 minutes. What you've triggered in that 20 minutes affects your subconscious. not everyone thinks that way, sir. A lot of people have grudges even at that stage.
Youngsters, you see, we undergo that, but the elders.
So youngsters are more expressive of it. If you look at, even if currently, if you look at the ailments that a lot of old people go through, you can see through the physical ailment what is the emotion running. Typically, a lot of them have joint pains. Joint pains are extremely indicative of relationship issues. Lack of trust in relationships, lack of dependency or over-dependency, that's typically what causes arthritis and rheumatism. If you look at cancer, cancer is a direct output of anger. Diabetes is a very direct output of bitterness in relationships. So, you see the disease and you know what the person is going through. So, it's not that old people are not prone to emotions. Maybe in some sense you're socially conditioned to say, all right, why should I have grudges? So behavior does not show it. That doesn't mean lack of emotion for everyone. Some of them, yes, do work it out, not all. In fact, there was a recent case of a suicide by someone who was about very close to 100. So that's not something that happens when a person is emotionally ill. Not everyone can overcome it that easily.
The elderly may also think it's part of, like, the doctor has to certify my death, so he has to write some cause of for my death.
That's
so, you see, with a medical background, you find out that something is going to go wrong because my body has to perish.
No, which is just a physical cause, but all physical ailments have an emotional root. It's never
but
only
it has
physical.
Not been scientifically proved. It is said so, not scientifically proved.
Oh, we have enough scientific
validation.
Oh, yes. Most alternative therapies work on the basis of that.
Can you show some evidence where?
There are a lot of research reports, especially for patients with cancer, with tumors, with diabetes, a whole lot of evidence available about the emotional causes.
What is the underlying cause for tumors?
Tumors, again, is because there's a lot of anger. Because there is anger, the body goes against itself. The cells multiply in a way that's unhealthy, right? Which means you're attacking yourself. Because there is a huge element of anger, and because the anger is not being channelized outward, at some point it needs to be channelized somewhere. So it's channelizing inward. I am angry with her all my life. For some reason, I'm not able to express that to her. I'm being socially nice to her. At some point, I have to express it, so then I express it in word. The cancer grows in me.
That's why I believe, because you're not able to forgive
frequent use of the pronoun I is an indicator of healing, because you realize you're owning up emotion, which by itself is an indicator. So words like I realize, I understand, all of these are indicative of healing. But remember, I'm talking of it from the analytical point of view. Don't start with the intention that I have to say I understand and I realize and all that. Don't edit your writing. Let it flow the way it does. You don't have to necessarily incorporate words. Let it flow naturally. When you write, you have to write 20 minutes straight. Even if you think you're repeating the same thing over and over again, do continue to write. No editing allowed. Okay? Absolutely no editing allowed. So, because ultimately, whatever you've written is for yourself. You don't have to show it to a therapist if you don't want, or you don't have to show it to anyone. So be extremely honest with it.
So you can show it.
If you wish to, you can. Not everyone may want to. Sometimes people...
After a month also, you can review it.
You can. It's just that sometimes with people who are living in large families and stuff, they may not want to have things lying around. So it's fine if you want to destroy it, but do review it once before you destroy it. So no editing allowed, and do review it after a couple of hours. Don't do it immediately if you're doing it on your own. With a therapist, it's a different thing, but if you're doing it on your own, give it a couple of hours break and then review what you did. And the idea is healing occurs when you remember the incident, but you're not overwhelmingly reacting to it. The emotion doesn't empower you. If you're at that stage, it means the healing is well on the way. Don't be surprised if there are disturbing dreams when you're in the process. It happens very often, and it also means that you're dealing with the issue at an astral level, so it's fine. So it's okay if you don't get scared if you have disturbing dreams.
Do you think that the subconscious mind plays the role when you are dreaming?
Oh yes, very much. Subconscious, unconscious, all of it. So dreams can be very frequent with some people. It's okay.
During writing only, our subconscious mind will let go.
Yeah. See, the process, what happens in the process is you're triggering a rise of emotion from unconscious or sometimes the subconscious into the conscious mind. Because once it's in the conscious mind, it's easy to deal with it. In the conscious mind, you can rationalize and you can talk of why the incident happened and what is the learning from it. That's not possible in the unconscious. So what you're doing is digging it out, bringing it up to the conscious. So yes, you're triggering the subconscious when you're writing.
What is the benefit of reviewing it after?
Reviewing it is to understand what's the pattern that you're falling into. Is the pattern about blaming somebody? Is the pattern of self-pity? Is it a pattern of sometimes not wanting to address the issue at all? Because sometimes your review may show that you're only describing the incident, you're not describing how you feel. So then the review helps, because otherwise it can be frustrating to write about the incident over and over again if you're not getting anywhere. Right? So somewhere you will need to direct your efforts when you're writing. Now, when you're doing it with a therapist, obviously the therapist is bound to force you in a certain direction. But if you're doing it by yourself, do review it, because then you know where to go.
Basically, reviewing it after some time helps you to understand it better, because that immediately you are in that same emotional upheaval.
Yeah.
So if you do it after a few hours, you benefit, because then you are out of it emotionally and you can look at it as an outsider.
Yes, you look at it more objectively. Because if you do it immediately, sometimes you're in the throes of that emotion and it might just magnify. So give it some time before you. That's the process, and like I said, if you do wish to share it with somebody, good enough, so long as the person does have a certain background of you and the incident, that may help. Otherwise, you may very well do it by yourself, so long as it's not an extremely traumatic issue.
It would even help if he's a total stranger, right?
A total stranger who's mature enough to handle it.
That is why people go down to therapists, but not the people at home.
Yeah, because sometimes you may not want to expose yourself in certain ways.
Total stranger where you're not going to meet again, or he's not going to come into your
home. Yes,
so
someone who would not judge you. Sometimes you're afraid of that judgment, which is okay, naturally.
Is that right?